Welcome to Genesis Unleashed, where the truth of Genesis is revealed.
And on today's episode, we're going to show why antibiotic resistance is not good evidence for evolution.
Genesis Unleashed. You know, a common argument that evolutionists use to say that evolution is happening before our eyes, you creationists, how silly you are because you can't see this science that's happening, these observations that are happening right here today, is antibiotic resistance. Bacteria, germs, things become resistant to antibiotics, the things that are meant to destroy them. And they hail that as evidence for evolution.
Right. So the idea is that certain germs that were once resistant to certain antibiotics all of a sudden develop antibiotic resistance means, and the implication is perhaps that they have something new that they never had before, so they've changed. That must be evolution.
Yes, they've adapted to a new environment with this antibiotic, and now they're able to, they've evolved the resistance to it, that they've developed the resistance. Those kind of terms are used there to describe what's going on.
So obviously something has happened. They've changed, but change does not equate to evolution. Many people think, well, if the creatures change, that must be proof of evolution. But of course, creationists believe that creatures can change over time. It's the type of change, really, that needs
exactly,
to be clarified
the type
here.
Of change.
What evolution would need to show is that there are changes in living things that are new and beneficial that never existed before. If you're going to turn a bacteria into something like a horse over millions of years, what would you need to do to the DNA instructions of a bacteria to turn it into a horse? You would need to write in a brand new bunch of new information that never existed before for functions, features, things that, you know, bacteria don't have. They don't have skin, and they don't have muscles, and they don't have bones, and they don't have blood. So where did all the genetic information come from? That's what evolution would need to show, that type
right.
of change.
Right.
So what kind of change do we see in bacteria?
Well, there's an article that we'll sort of summarize here a little bit. You can find that at creation.com/evolution and medicine, with dashes in between the evolution and medicine. Creation.com, evolution and medicine. One of the points we could make is that the drug-resistant bacteria were already resistant to the drug.
Right. So in a certain population of these germs that develop resistance, some of them already have genetic information that's resisting the antibiotic.
Yes, yes. We can imagine a whole, you know, billions of little bacteria.
Right.
And a percentage of those are already resistant. And so all of the others are wiped out,
right?
And then the population of bacteria in the hospital or in your body, if in the kidneys in this case, those bacteria that are already resistant go on to reproduce, and they become the dominant bacteria, and they are resistant to the antibiotics. So the resistance was already there. That's the first point that we can make.
Right. And you'll see that, you know, when you're using your hand soap there, and it says kills 99.9%.
Right.
I always wonder why it didn't kill 100%.
Yeah. So now you've got you already have some germs on your hands that are resistant to the hand cleanser.
That's right.
And those bacteria are not going to reproduce, and you'll have a whole strain of bacteria on your hands that are resistant to any hand sanitizer.
And actually, there are examples. When they recovered, you know, sometimes these explorers go off up north and unfortunately they die, and they find their bodies years later, hundreds of years later after the expedition. They've actually found that some of the bacteria on the corpse are resistant to antibiotics that we developed
many years later. Yes.
So
yes.
That's proof, again, that the bacteria already had resistance.
Those bacteria from that body many, many years ago were already resistant to the to the antibiotics.
So obviously they didn't evolve to something new we created. The second point is that some bacteria can actually exchange information for resistance. So plasmid transfer, little coils of DNA that the information for resistance. So one bacteria can sidle up to another one, pop out this little tube, you know, kind of inject it into the other bacteria, and shoot over information,
DNA.
Transfer information. Yeah. And so evolutionists, some have said, well, look, now this bacteria has something that it didn't have before.
Which is true.
But if I hand you, you know, a book, and you didn't have that book before, And now you have that book of information. That's not...
It misses the point of the argument, doesn't it?
Yeah.
Because it's not new, never before existing genetic information.
Right.
If we think let's keep the game before us here. The game is to evolve from a single cell essentially, or nothing.
Yep.
To humans, or to some higher life form.
You haven't explained where the book I gave you came from.
Exactly. Yeah. It was already pre-existing.
Right.
Another point that we can make is where it has arisen from a genetic copying mistake. A mutation. There's a mutation which causes a benefit. It causes a survival benefit. A bacteria might have a mutation that allows it to get around the antibiotic. But again, that doesn't fit our definition, the definition of what evolution needs to get. New, never before existing genetic information.
Well, if it's a mutation that would somehow create a new bit of information that did cause resistance in the fact that it was a new function or new feature that had never before existed, but the type of mutation that we observe are the types of mutations that are actually breaking things down. For example, we use the example of H. pylori.
H. pylori is a famous example. Yeah. So the bacteria, this one lives in your stomach, it eats the lining of your stomach, you have too many, you get ulcers, you get holes in your stomach lining. And it's controlled with an antibiotic, and when the antibiotic is applied, actually inside the bacteria produces an enzyme that converts the antibiotic into a toxin which kills the bacteria. There's a mutant variety, which is well known in the science community. Mm-hmm. There's a mutant variety which lacks the ability to produce that enzyme, so that antibiotic is not converted into a toxin, and the bacteria survives the antibiotic.
Right.
It has a beneficial mutation, but it's not a gain of information. It lost the ability to produce the enzyme. So it's going in the opposite direction of evolution.
Right.
So again, there's an example, H. pylori, that doesn't support evolution story.
Right. It used to have an enzyme. Now it doesn't have an enzyme.
Right.
That was a benefit to it. It's a beneficial mutation, but it's a subtraction of information. That's going in the wrong direction for what evolutionists need to show. So in summary, you apply antibiotics to a population of bacteria, and those lacking the resistance, they're going to die out, right?
They'll get wiped out.
Right. If they don't already have resistance, they're gone.
Yes.
Right? And then those that are left, of course, are going to reproduce, and you can try using the same antibiotic over and over and over again. You're not going to get a different result because they already had resistance, right? So actually, what you're doing is you're culling out a certain group of information. Those that you get rid of, you've gotten rid of the information, whatever genetics they had. You're only left with what already has resistance to your antibiotic. And so actually, again, that's natural selection in action. Creationists believe in natural selection, but that's no help to the theory of evolution. So if this is supposedly one of the best proofs of evolution, antibiotic resistance,
yeah.
Evolution's in big trouble as far as proof.